Yeah, good morning. Let's resume our discussion. So before I start, could one of you or a few of you brief, what did we discuss in the last class? So what did we discuss in the last class? Last Wednesday, what was our discussion?
We discussed about computer vision tasks like classification, segmentation, and network architecture of segmentation.
Yeah, very good. So we discussed about computer vision. We are discussing about computer vision applications of convolution neural networks. In that, more specifically, we have discussed about segmentation networks. So we have seen the network architecture, how should be for segmentation. Fine. So let's continue that discussion. And then in this class, let us kind of discuss on the object detection as well. So if you have any questions on that, you can ask. And then probably we'll go ahead with subsequent discussions. So while discussing, I will share some thoughts on both segmentation and object detection, which are of the state of the art even now. Okay, so mainly if we discussed about the segmentation networks has to have either say fully convolutional network architectures, like we have seen that so where the input image size and the output label size has to be same, or this like this is computationally intensive. So or the alternative is we can have a network architecture which is encoder and decoder kind of networks where we encode features in terms of small size like feature maps and subsequently decode them to the labels, giving the pixel wise image classification. That's segmentation. That's nothing but the segmentation. And while doing so in the decoder, what we need is a kind of upsampling. So that can be done through unpooling, or it can be done through transpose convolutions or fractionally strided convolutions. Say probably even by conventional upsampling. So these we have discussed. And also some of the networks take the advantage of the locations where there are max pooled or the dimension reduction is happening in the encoder layers. So those locations, they will also keep track for doing the decoding operations in the corresponding layer. Okay, so if we consider that this is the encoder and this is the decoder, okay, and these two can be considered as corresponding layers of the encoder and decoder. Okay, small, same scale layers. Okay, so from here to here, whatever is the max pooling that is done, that may be used to do max unpooling. Okay, so putting the samples in the higher like resolution or say large dimensional or double the dimensional feature maps at the corresponding locations where we have got the previous maximum values in the previous in the decoder. So the decoder and encoder can also be coupled. So in this way, that's done in some of the networks. Okay, so and upsampling can also be done through learning. Learning in the sense that we may learn a 3x3 filter to do upsampling here from this map to this map. So if we are learning 3x3 filter means, what that does is at every location, you multiply with the lower dimensional map, the corresponding value or the corresponding the value at that location with the map or with the kernel and put them at that place. So if we consider this is 0, 0, we multiply with the kernel with this value and put it here. Okay. Or if we consider this as 0, 0, we can completely embed and put it here. Okay. So, and then subsequently we do the same at this location. So other 3x3, 3x3 kernel multiplied with the value here will come here. Okay. And similarly, this one will come here, okay, and this one will come here. Like that, when we do the multiplication, it's like tiling in the higher dimensional feature map with the stride more than one in the output, okay? That is fractional stride when we consider with respect to the input. When we do that, and then at the overlapping regions, if we just sum them, because anyway, weighted sum is what we are doing. It's nothing but the averaging. So we get the higher dimensional feature map through learning. So in that, what effectively we are learning is either 3 cross 3 kernel or 5 cross 5 kernel, whereas this is lower dimensional feature map and this is the corresponding higher dimensional feature maps related through the convolution operation, but this is fractionally straighted convolution or transpose convolution. Okay, this is what we have discussed mainly in the last class. We have seen some of the mathematics to understand why it is called transpose convolution through matrix, bringing analogy from the matrix multiplications, matrix vector multiplications of convolution. Okay, so this is what we discussed in the last class. If you have any quick questions, you can ask. Otherwise, I will move on with the subsequent discussions. Okay, so assume that the things are clear up to here. Okay. So fine, see, many of the networks, not only segmentation networks and the deep learning networks, but many of the networks, deep learning networks, especially for computer vision tasks, they do leverage from the computer vision developments. See, in computer vision, what is known or what can be thought of intuitively is the information in the image is like will be differently seen at different resolutions. Okay, so some of the finer details, it is easy to notice only in a very fine resolution or a very good high resolution. But some of the coarser details you can notice even in the small resolution or low resolution. Okay, so this is somewhat different from, you can also consider coarse to fine, but you can also, this is somewhat different from coarse to fine. This is more looking at different resolutions. Okay, so multi-resolution analysis is also well known in signal processing in general and also in image processing and computer vision. So the deep networks also use some such kind of techniques in their development. So this is referred to as RefineNet. So multi-path refinement networks for high resolution semantic segmentation. This is the title of the paper. And most of these works, which are incremental advancements in the research, are all published in a very good conferences and journals. Because even though they are incremental, they are substantial given compared to the earlier ones. So you can see that here, what they're doing is they are bringing the feature maps into 4 different dimensions. Okay, and each of the dimension they will try to see what's the next feature map are the high level features are the next set of features. Okay, and with these features will be subsequently used, next level features will be subsequently used directly through the you may have multiple stages like this, but even a single stage after this you may get some features. And these features, after assimilate the information from different scales, these features are used for predicting the class levels, okay, for segmentation. So what we are doing effectively in this is, we are predicting from the high resolution, what is the segmentation information? Also, we are predicting from the low resolution, what is segmentation information? See, for 4 pixels, you may be giving a single label here. Okay, for here, for 2 pixels, you may be giving single label, and here each pixel you may be giving single label, like that. So if you bring down dimension by 2, you are giving labels to lesser number of, say, for a bigger region, a single label. That's how it is happening. And then what you do is we make some correction and we use this information in the high level labeling. In sense that if you are able to label for 4 pixels to 1 class, then it's likely that the other samples may also be belongs to around that class. Okay, so that we will refine subsequently from level to level. That's done in this network. So you can see that actually they have subsampled, and after they perform feature extraction to 1 more stage, okay, they may again upsample to get the features all at same level. Okay, and then they will fuse the feature maps or feature information and subsequently perform class like pixel level classification or segmentation with those. So this is just an idea to come up with different kind of networks, where instead of having a uniform structure, considering all image pixels in a single way or at same resolution, you can consider the, or you can look the image also at different resolutions. Okay, and then analyze at different resolutions, and the analysis information can be refined from coarse to fine resolution. I hope this is clear. This kind of things are well known in computer vision, and they brought these things also to neural networks. Now, in fact, a few of the very top performing segmentation networks use this kind of techniques. So segmentation can be applied in different data sets. One data set where segmentation is very widely applied is the cityscape data set, where we have actually the images of city with vehicles, persons, and road scenarios. So this is the segmentation results. As you can see, at each pixel, the label is provided, whether it is a, say, a traffic light, or trees, road, and so on, vehicles, cars, and so on. This is one of the very widely applied or important application for segmentation. The other application, there are, of course, very important other applications as well. So one is satellite image segmentation, where you have actually satellite images. We want to classify each pixel into road, building, water, land, and so on. So different classes. It depends upon the number of classes, how fine segmentation need to be done with different classes. The other data sets are, say, some of the natural images data sets, and few other data sets are of importance is medical image segmentation data sets, where they wish to segment either cancerous cells versus non-cancerous, or they want to regions of cancer in the mammograms, breast cancer region or mass detection, or they want to classify nucleus versus the cell, cytoplasm and other details of the cell, and so on. So there are plenty of problems related to MRI segmentation, for example, is one more slightly different version of the segmentation problem. So there are plenty of the problems that can benefit from segmentation methods. For each deep learning works, the one good thing is most of the publications, they accept papers with code as well. So on top conferences, they will, in fact, most of the top conference papers, they make available their codes. So papers with code, if you just check in the internet, you will see good number of methods, recent methods, and there are leaderboards for each of these applications. So you can see them, which is performing top now and so on. What's the method kind of? In fact, for most of them, even video demonstrations or discussions are also available. So you can see a series of networks for semantic segmentation, especially in cityscape scenario here, and here in medical imaging. There are some very celebrated networks for segmentation. So you can see that SegNet are fully convolutional networks, are the initial networks that have come up for the semantic segmentation. And subsequently in medical imaging, UNET, UNET++, RetinaNet, etc. has come. And there are similar, as I mentioned, there are different architectures using the leveraging from computer vision ideas. So such as RefineNet and HRNet, which is the now top performing segmentation network, which use multi resolutions and attentions as well. So nowadays, bringing attention or the regions of interest through transformer networks is also of importance. Such things are also brought in into the segmentation. Mask RCNN is also a segmentation network. It does through the idea of object detection, which we will discuss now. So if you have any questions on the segmentation methods, please ask now. Otherwise, I will start moving on to the discussion on the object detection. Okay, so assume no questions, moving on. Okay, see, what's the object detection? As you know, So we want to detect different objects in an image. Usually we may not be bothered about the background, and we would like to bring in some of the objects which are like are importance are there in the data set. Essentially, when we are considering a particular application. What we want to do for the detection of object is we want to localize it. We want to say which object it is. Say, let it be cat, dog, or a bike, or a car, or a person, and so on. And we want to give the coordinates or exactly location of the object. So in terms of coordinates can be given, as I mentioned before, in terms of the XY, the corners, and then height and width. This is one way of giving the coordinates. There are some other methods which will give center, okay, and then height and width. Okay, there are some other methods which gives corners, one or two corners. Okay, and then say that this is instead of giving the whole bounding box, they may mainly look at identifying the corner points. Okay, and from there they will try to bring in some kind of understanding to on the size of the object. So different methods for object detection have evolved. So let's see now what essentially we need to do and what kind of architectures do we need to perform object detection. So let me just discuss in the slide itself. So let's see now how should be the object detection network. So any thoughts on how should it be? See, if you want to detect an object, let me discuss in the iPad. Okay, so assume that we have an image and we want to detect objects in it. Let's first assume that we want to detect one object in an image. Okay, so just to be more clear or precise, we want to detect persons. So here is a person and here is a person. Okay, or even single object we want to detect. Okay, where is the person in this image? We just want to detect. Okay, other than classification, what's of importance here? So some quick thoughts are necessary to move forward. We have here a CNN architecture or convolution neural networks. Okay, and how should it be? That's the question. How should be the architecture of the CNN? Okay, or let it be convolution plus some other network is fine, a neural network. Yeah, quick thoughts on it. See, in computer vision, what people used to do is, say if there are cars and if there are different objects. So what they used to do is they want to identify the regions of interest where the objects are. So this is referred to as, region selection networks, or say there are some networks which will try to identify the region of interest for where the object may be. So object proposals are, they would like to bring in the regions or the proposal for the region of the object. So region selection networks kind of methods. So what they do is they give some score for each of the point for the objectiveness, say for being object being present in that. So the object score at each pixel or at each region. Object or objectness score. Okay, so what happens? Here the score is high, assume that it is say 0.8, 0.9, okay, 0.7 and so on. Outside 0.2, 0.3, okay, 0.5 and so on. Again, here it may be 0.7, 0.8, 0.6 and so on. And here 0.9, 0.6, okay, 0.8 and so on. And again 0.2, 0.10 and so on. Okay, so what they do is for each of the pixels, they assign some object to nest score. Okay, so through this, what happens? We say that there is a possibility of object. Once the possibility of object is there, they will try to bring in some kind of, merging with respect to the objectiveness scores or having the high probability of being objects. So because they want, usually objects are closed in nature. You can't expect one object to add some four pixels and so on, is it not? So objects are there in regions or patches. So they will try to bring, initially they will try to quantify the objectiveness for each of the pixels. Once they quantify the objectiveness, they, what they do, they couple or they bring through some kind of morphological operations or some kind of operations to say that these are the clustering operations, grouping operations, saying that this is the rough region in which object is there, object one, okay, and object two, and object three. Okay, remaining regions, if there are very small, say this 0.9 also, we leave it because there is no substantial pixels around, or there is not many pixels around which can compose an object. Okay, so this is the first step. So it's in some sense, they're doing is region of interest for objects we are trying to find out. Okay, this is the conventional way of doing. So then what they do, so in that regions, they would like to figure out which object it is. Then what's the procedure? Can one of you tell? A quick answer is welcome. Hope the discussion is clear. Okay. Sandeep, is it clear? Are you able to understand? Srihari? Prabhat?
Yes, sir. But what actually, how to make the network do this task?
We are not yet discussing on CNN networks doing this. We are just telling about conventional methods.
We can use regular convolution as template matching.
Yeah, we will do that. I will clarify about the convolution neural networks doing object detection.
No, sir. I'm talking about regular convolution, like template matching.
Okay, you are saying template classification. Okay, can that be used for finding out this? Oh, you are saying how do we give the object a score, correct?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, yes. That's true in terms of, yes. So what they do is they say they have object templates. So template 1 to template 10. So they have actually, say for each of the object also, they may have several templates, but assume that we have actually for class 1 to class 10. Okay, and for each of the templates, you may have actually each of the class, you may have template 1 to template say 50 or whatever. Okay, like this. Then what we do is using this, we want to give some kind of say, we would like to give a feature vector for each of them. So feature vectors conventionally what we consider for an object are, what kind of feature vectors can one of you comment? What feature vectors do we extract in images? Any answer? What is feature extraction that we use?
Key points. Key points.
Yeah, okay. Key points is one thing to identify objects. And what else? Hey, any other students or Prabhat itself?
Maybe edges.
Okay, edges. What else? Okay, what else? We have discussed in the previous course as well.
HOD features.
Yeah, HOD features. Histogram of orientation gradients. These are one of the very good features. Okay, so they will give edges in the sense that edge angles also they will give. In a given object, Okay, so they will give, in fact, for the whole image they may give. Okay, if we have a template, object template, for that we will get. Okay, so this is one of the object. When we have the labels, this is the object template. Okay, and this we will get actually angles. So histogram of orientation gradients is say angle of edges. Histogram of angle of edges. Okay, we get. Okay, and in fact, histogram is also a good feature sometimes. Okay, if it is, problem is simple, histogram itself. There are few others, local binary patterns, okay, which I have not discussed, local binary pattern based features. We also have Fisher vector, bag of visual words, okay, so these are all different features. So, in fact, the bag of visual words and Fisher vector are built upon H1Z features, which we have not discussed. And local binary patterns is essentially good feature for textures. So they will extract all these features. So bag of visual words will give, in fact, for a whole of this set of templates, they will give a set of features. Okay, kind of code words for that object class. Those who know a little bit of communication, okay, if you want to represent a set of a class of vectors or a class of signals, you can use the kind of code words, okay, or the quantized representatives for that class of samples. Okay, so such are bag of visual words. Similarly, on the top of it, we use some other movements also in some more information to get the Fisher vector and so on. So given all this, we just get the features. And that this at each location, we assume that there is a patch. We take a patch. Okay, if we want to see if there is an object or not, we take a patch. And in that patch, we try to see, okay, with any of these things, what is the similarity score? Okay, so it's not purely, you can consider it as convolution because we do it at each pixel, not only at a given pixel or at a given location. And wherever the score is high for that class, we assume that the object is there. Okay, so like that. Is it clear? Yeah, Prabhat, is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you can ask if not fully clear.
I had a question, sir. How do we actually get high scores for multiple objects in the same thing?
Take the features of each object and then try to do this operation. See, what usually is done in conventional methods is they don't do it at each pixel. Most of them are, say, feature-based in sense that, of course, they can do at each pixel. But more importantly, what they do is they know that the objects will not be presented all over. So first, what is first done is, say, before even this feature extraction stage, first key points are taken. Okay, so you can consider from here, they will note the key points. Around key points, they will take patches. Okay, and then for that patch, they also have for each of the templates, they also have actually, if there is a person or whatever, they also have different key points here. Around each key point, they also have patches. Okay, patches of informations, and what they want to do is at each key point, they want to compare with any of these things, with all of these things, in fact. Even if it matches with respect to one of them, they will give some high score, objective score here. So like that, say if you have actually, say, 10 key points for a object one, and then up to class 10, if we see second class two, you may have actually, so for 20. And like that, if you see overall, if you have 100 or say 1,000 key points representing all classes. Okay, 1,000 key points means what? Around 1,000 key points, you also have features, descriptors. So they have actually 1,000 feature descriptors. And at any, now you have the test base. In this test image, what they do? So they take a particular key point. They are first extract key points. Assume that we have actually 50 key points. okay, in this test image. So what we do is we see the similarity with all these 50 key points with respect to these 1000 key points. With any key point, if we have a reasonably high score of similarity, then we consider it as an objectness score. Okay, so that like we code into the similarity can be coded into the probability. That highest one is considered and given as a probability. Like that we do at all 50 key points, and then 50 key points gets the scores. And out of 50, say 40 may be considered and 10 may be thrown out because they are not similar to any of these objects. Our object patches are points.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So like this, they will do. This is the usually the background work. So there are few other ways. This is a feature-based method. The other ways are, what they do is they try to apply some kind of clustering. Say, even in face detection, for example, they first see all low variance points, okay, and then eliminate them. Wherever the variance is less than some, like some threshold, we assume it is a uniform and there is no object there. So they do say when there is a high variance, they try to see that there is an object. So that kind of methods are also there. They doesn't need to deal with the object features, nothing. Okay, they try to see, is there a variation in the signal in that region or not? If there is a reasonable variation, there is some object. What that object is, okay, then subsequently we will try to figure out. Okay, so if you see that in this region, whatever we have considered here, okay, so in this region, there is a, say, subsequent, the most of the pixels has variation. Okay, then we assume that there is an object. These are even simpler procedures where we try to clearly, like first identify, is there some object or not, some information or not. And then subsequently, we want to tell what object it is. Okay, so those also can give objectness scores. Okay, so in the second, in the first discussion, whichever I had, we consider the feature points, feature key points and feature descriptors. Okay, there we will be giving rough estimate of the class probabilities or confidence as well. Okay, in this case, actually where we are trying to find out the high variance regions and then cluster them, high variance regions and say that there is a object. Oh, we are trying to do what we are doing is region of interest identification. Okay, for objects. There we will search and try to extract features and so on. At other regions, we don't even extract features. Okay, is this clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, fine. Okay. So this is how conventionally it is done. Now we want to see how is it done in convolution neural networks. See, if you want to bring in convolution neural network architecture, okay, what do you think? How this should be? Initial developments, what they are targeted is, so they try to target detecting each object. Say, assume that actually I somehow use this conventional computer vision methods and get the region of interest. Okay, so assume that I have got three regions of interest. Then what we do, at each region of interest, so our region of interest one, okay, and then region of interest three. Okay, at each region of interest, I may be putting a bounding box. Okay. And for each of the bounding box, I am trying to acquire some features or take some features. Okay. First, what we do is region of interest identification. Okay. As in CV, region selection approaches, object selection. Okay, and then what we do is we take, say, some regions now. They may be of different dimensions. Okay, so what we do is we try to bring in some kind of common grounds, because feature extraction, all CNNs will have a, most of the CNNs require some kind of specific input dimensions. Of course, now if it is fully convolution network, it doesn't need that. So you can have actually different dimensions as well as input, because the only convolution operations are happening, and you can do it convolution, say from map to map, whatever may be the dimension, you can still apply same kernel. Okay, so if it is fully convolution networks, then you can give different input sizes. But if it is a convolution neural network in general, having different convolution layers, pooling layers, and then subsequently some fully connected layers, then you may then you need to decide on the dimensions. So you bring each of them to same dimension and then put as input. Why are we using CNN here? So after region selection, okay, methods we have used initially are object selection methods. So why are we using CNN here? What is the reason for using convolution neural network here? Any quick answer?
The feature extraction process can be abstracted.
Yeah, so we will get much more better features to understand what is there in that region. Okay, so you apply CNN, but the CNN, how this should be, finally what we need here is what X, okay, Y, H and W and class score, okay, confidence. So probability of class belonging to a particular class. So these are essentially the output variables we wish to get. Okay, so it's a five-dimensional vector, 5x1 vector. So you can consider to regress. So, but only thing is each of them you can do and then try to put into one of these. You can say initially have the ground truth and according to that you can backpropagate. Okay, and do this, say this is done through regression process. So this is one way of doing. But the problem with this way of doing is, see, you are not using the whole image or processing the whole image at once. You are trying to figure out each of the where the objects are, and use the again same CNN, okay, for say each of the region and extract their features independently, one after the other. Okay, so in very initial methods, referred to as RCNN method, so used to do this kind of technique. First use the region selection or the region of interest, and then where the objects are, and then use the like CNN architecture to regress and give the object class and the bounding box of the object. See, one more problem here is you are trying to find X, Y and H, W. X, Y, H, W, if you want to see, essentially it is better to see in the image. Okay, so you can have actually the neighborhood information and you can effectively see it in the image. But if you just give a patch and it is little, in sense that even if you give a little higher dimension than the patch, it is not easy to localize the object. Okay, so the next set of methods, what they have come up is, say, why should we break this region selection, okay, and the feature extraction into different stages? Can we couple them is the question. Moreover, can we avoid somehow, say, that still the like they used to use computer vision methods, but subsequently what the idea is, can we avoid computer vision methods for identifying the regions? See, what does computer vision methods does? They does very exhaustively searching at each patch. They start from this patch, okay, this patch, okay, and then at different resolutions, not just even at one resolution, and try to see the whether the object is there or not. Okay, if we don't go by key point method, which I have discussed before, or if we don't go by just variance based methods, essentially, what we will be doing it is each patch we are trying to see whether there is an object or not. Okay, so it's very costly or very computationally intensive. So avoiding such computer vision methods, even for identifying the regions of objects, any object, is also is very like important or useful to reduce the computational complexity. And naturally, they also have seen that it improves the accuracy. Because what they are essentially doing is the whole process can be learned together in the sense that where the region is, object is present, that also can be posed as a learning problem. And what the class of the object also can be posed as a learning problem. So there are two advancements mainly that are done. One is, say, anyway, since we are doing feature extraction for each individual objects here, instead of doing individual first selecting the regions of the objects, okay, and then doing the feature extraction, can we do first the feature extraction and then select the objectness and objects, region, rough region of the objects or region of interest of the objects, and apply the CNN mainly for localizing, okay, not for unclassification, okay, not for feature extraction, not only for feature extraction, because feature extraction through CNN is already done. So the idea now is, if you have the image, okay, first apply feature extraction stage. This can be a CNN now. So you get now a set of features for the image. Okay, so these can be in terms of feature maps as well. Okay, and from these feature maps, they are, say you have the spatial information here. And then you find out the, with respect to the spatial information, where the object is. Okay, so for finding out the objects, okay, so region of objects, you may still use kind of computer vision methods, region selection methods, or region of interest methods. Okay, and then localize the objects. In all feature maps, you will get the same, right? So you have actually, in all feature maps, you will be finding out the objects. Okay, so you know, because they are spatially mapped, you can see where the object is. Okay, so like that you do, and then extract the features in that regions. Okay, so directly you're extracting now feature maps. Okay, so once you give the region of interest, you are extracting feature maps directly. And from these feature maps, actually now the main aim is X, Y, H, and W. Okay, and class code. Okay, this view, can we do it? So this is mainly feature extraction network. Okay, and this is actually classification network mainly. Classification and regression network. What classification? Object classification. Okay, this is the next advancement. This is referred to as faster RCNN. Okay, subsequently, fast RCNN. Okay, subsequently, there is another method. What it, as we discussed, that tries to avoid computer vision completely, even for region selection. So here, intermediately, computer vision is used based on region of interest selection for objects. So what that idea of that approach is, you anyway apply feature extraction using CNN, and then you have feature maps. See, let's suppose the region of interest identification also, okay, as a learning problem. So we want to say actually through here, each pixel, okay, whether it belongs to foreground or background. So it's a classification problem. Okay, and we want to say, what's the objectiveness score? Probability or score. Okay, so this is what, this is essentially, if you have actually, at each location, we would like to bring in the classification, like foreground, background, and the regression in terms of the object, like object probabilities. Okay, so this is parallelly done. So you use the same feature maps again for performing one more thing. That is actually, along with the information that we get here, we use both of them and try to do what? Here we would like to tell which object it is. Okay, so here also you have again bounding boxes. But here we are telling only foreground or background. Here you are telling which object. Okay, so essentially you need to give class probabilities, all class probabilities. Here this probability is just objectiveness score. It doesn't matter to which class does it belongs to. Okay, here, but in this case, you are trying to see which class it belongs to. Okay, and also you will be giving the exact coordinates x, y, and h, w. Of course, here also, if you want to give a kind of object, you need to give X, Y, and HW. Object localization is also roughly done. So through this foreground and background, the X, Y, and HW, object localization is also done. Okay, here course, and here fine object localization. Along with that, we are trying to give actually the objectness course for C classes. Okay, is this clear?
Sir, a small question.
Yeah, please ask.
Sir, how is this less computational intensive than the initial part? Because we are actually breaking this down into three different steps.
Yeah, so only thing is here, there is no computer vision method. Computer vision methods, as I said, they will scan at different scales. See, if you want to see the object at different scales, they will put actually, say, anchor boxes. Say, here one anchor and see, higher, different time, at each pixel, they may be using 4 or 5 different scales of the scanning for the object. To give the objectness score. So let it be, it's there both in RCNN and fast RCNN. Because we are trying to tell the objectiveness score not through learning, but through computer vision methods, through in some sense, through X has to search over the either image map or the feature maps. And that's the change from here to here.
Yes, sir.
And this also adds in the testing case. See, in testing also, if you have a new object, here you need to again apply the computer vision method. And X has to research all locations where the object is. Okay, and the training phase versus testing phase, there is no saving when we apply this computer vision based method, or very less saving. Even though once you extract features, you may be applying some kind of classifiers like support vector machine or some kind of classifiers to decide in case if you're using, you're not purely computer vision. But even in that case, there is not much change. Whereas here, training versus testing, if you see, there is a lot of saving. If in training, we are doing all these back propagations and so on and freezing the weights. Okay, and then in testing, simply they will give the object, say, the region proposals. Okay, this is referred to as region proposal network. And you take these region proposals and then trying to give the bounding box X, Y, S, W more finely, and also give the class scores for all the C classes.
Yes, sir. There's also one more question, sir. Here initially, in the last network, you're initially extracting the features, feature maps, and then calculating the, identifying whether it's on foreground or background, right?
Right.
But why don't we unify the whole process? Because now also, anyways, it is both of them are
being. In this case, you are telling?
In the last case, sir.
In the last case, how do we unify? See, here we are extracting features for the whole image, not for patches. Okay. And nowhere we are separating into, say, patches. Oh, yeah. In fact, even here, once we consider through image processing or computer vision, we get the bounding box, we will be using features. Only thing is here we may be using the region around the object to do this. But in this case, we are extracting features whole together. So each time, say here, if I'm taking, usually what we do is this is the object. We don't take this much only. We take double the object size. In even objects, say instead of 3, I may initially say that 20 objects may also look at. All 20 may not be like objects really. But still, during the initial phase, I may detect as 20 possibilities for objects. And there may be reasonable overlap in the feature extraction. So you see that here itself, say, because I am giving each patch, in this itself, there may be good repetitions of different patches. So I'm extracting features again and again, and each time I'm scaling up to the dimension of the CNN and doing this. So not much saving in this case, because there is a good repetition in feature extraction stage itself. Okay, on the top of it, computer vision is also there where we are trying to bring in the region of interest detection. So here what we see is actually feature extraction is done all together once. We are doing for 3 times, 10 times and so on, if even if there are repetitions of the object region proposals. Okay, but now what we are doing is feature extraction is done in a very effective way. But still, the reason of interest for object is being done through computer vision, through a little bit of search and comparisons. So that takes time. Okay, and then we subsequently, each patch we are trying to give the regression. Here, if you see the whole patch, you whole image, you perform feature extraction only once. Okay, and the regression at each, say we are doing, of course, at say, yet different grid points, probably we may be doing. So we are doing either at each point or different points on the back propagation of X, Y, Z, W. So essentially the dimension of vector, if you see, so usually here also we select the anchor points at the possible, say, to see the details in different dimensions. We have different procedures. So to see whether the object may be in small scale or bigger scale and different scales, at each location, you may be doing 4 times or 5 times, okay, or k times. Okay, k are the number of anchor boxes means k times. But k into foreground or background is only classification and regression, 5 times. So x, y, h, w is what you need to do. And then foreground or background classification score you need to do. Okay, so that kind of thing you are doing here. Okay, so here what you are doing is x, y, h, w, and then the class scores. Okay, so the as a number of classes you have. Okay, plus 5 times the X, Y, S, W. And if you have K anchors and so on, this is you need to do at each grid point or at a different pixels that you consider. So essentially back propagation is done at multiple places, not just at one place. Okay, but the feature extraction and then the region of interest, they're all learned through convolutions only, or through regression and a small networks, fully connected network.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, clear, sir.
Yeah. So let me now, since the time is less, let me move on to the slides and discuss a little bit on the, with some visual description that we have from the Professor Fifi team. Yeah, this is the object detection. Initially, say if you would like to bring in object detection at different locations in the image, what we need to do is we need to do this process of localizing at different patches. Okay, and you need to do regression and classification as well. Okay, so subsequent, like this can be single object or multiple objects. Of course, we are taking the features of whole image, so you can do the concatenated features and then do for the whole image where the object is only one kind of one back propagation. Okay, so you need not do in each patch, but you can do at once with the full features. However, you need to do for each object at least once if you consider each object as a different entity. Okay, so it's say if you keep increasing the number of objects, then this will increase and it is not very practical because we don't know a priori how many objects we may have. And then the architectures evolved based on say computer vision methods using sliding window based search. There are several possible sliding windows. At each patch decided by the sliding window, we will try to give the objectiveness score. Okay, and we see that which is a like finally we apply non-maxima suppression and so on, and then decide which are the possible regions for the objects. Okay, so this is a selective search kind of methods. So they will search if not at all pixels or at all locations, they will selectively see in regions where there is a high variance and try to give some kind of completeness or the like objectiveness score or complete bounding box for the objects. They may not exactly identify which object it is, but they are need to be done across the whole image in some sense, even though it's selective, it takes time. So the first development, as I mentioned, is feature extraction is done for each object proposal that is given by computer vision methods, or the like the region proposals given by computer vision methods. Okay, so and then subsequently, feature extraction is done at multiple times, and same convert may be used at all locations. Finally, we may be regressing for HYXW, HWXY, and then giving the classification scores. And subsequently, as I mentioned, we take the feature extraction as a single step or for all whole image at once. And then we use the region proposals through computer vision and use the like classification and regression to identify the location, exact location of the object and the class codes. So as I mentioned, the detection of object can be done in different ways because the objects, like localizing the objects can be done in different ways. So the objects may appear at different scales or resolutions and views in different images. Okay, so we need to search at lower scale, higher scale and so on. So one way of doing that is through multi-resolution analysis, as I mentioned. The other way of doing it through, say, downsampling the image and then applying the same filter or CNN. Other way of doing is applying filter set of different sizes. So 5x5, 7x7, 9x9 and so on. Other way of doing is take the same region or feature map and scale it up to our different, scale it to match the anchor boxes. And the ground truth also you match to these anchor boxes. These anchors are in between, okay? They are the common between the patch of the feature map that you get through region of interest pooling and the ground truth. And you both bring into say four, five different aspect ratios and dimensions because one time the object may be small, one time object may be big and so on. Each time ground truth will be mapped to them. So with same ground truth with different scales of features in the objects in the image, you're trying to see which is best anchor. This may be sometimes better, this may be better, this may be better, depending upon the size of the object. Okay, like that we do. So, and that's done of that's also done in these networks. So I probably conclude here since the time is up. Oh, so this is the final block diagram for FastRCNN where we discussed bounding box regression and classification means only object or non-object, that's all. Okay, here C class of objects also will be given and define bounding box regression. As you can see, so even though there is a two pass of backpropagation to the objects and features here, feature extraction stage, but each has some different, slightly different kind of training. Okay, so I will stop here. And then discuss in the next class few more methods for object detection. If you have any quick questions, let's take. Otherwise, we will meet during the next class. Yeah, thank you.